Professor Dragoš Ivtimie from Lyon University will talk about the influence of obstacles in the large-time behavior of viscous incompressible fluids.
Okay. Thank you very much for the invitation to give a talk at this Vortices School. I'm very happy to be back in Brazil. The first time was 14 years ago, and I'm still very happy to come back almost once every 2 years. So, I will talk about the large-time behavior of a viscous incompressible fluid in the sphere of an obstacle. So this is joint work with Christoph Lacav and Gregor Karsch. So the setting is the following. We are considering the incompressible Navier-Stokes equation in exterior domain, which can be in R2 or R3. So I recall here the Navier-Stokes equation. The viscosity is supposed to be just equal to 1, because it is not going to move. So U is divergence free, of course. It vanishes on the boundary, so we are assuming homogeneous Dirichlet boundary conditions. And we are giving an initial velocity. So the aim is to describe the large-time behavior of the solution, what happens as t goes to infinity. Well, if you are on a bounded domain, it's trivial that the solution goes to zero exponentially fast. That's a simple estimate from the Poincaré inequality. But on unbounded domains, this is not true anymore. In fact, in the full plane, there was a lot of work in this direction that I will mention a little bit later. But okay, in the full plane, the situation is much better understood than in exterior domains. So we'd like to compare the large time behavior in the exterior domain with the large time behavior in RL, in the full plane or the full space, depending on the space dimension. In particular, we also want to know if the obstacle can change the large time behavior or not. Now, it can be easily seen that the large time behavior of solution depends a lot on the behavior at infinity of the initial velocity, u0. So if u0 is fast decaying at infinity, then you expect the solution to be fast decaying in time. I also explain why. Now, so what should we assume on the initial data? That's the first question that we ask ourselves. What is physically and mathematically reasonable to put as a hypothesis on the initial data? But from the mathematical point of view, you have basically two settings to solve the Navier-Stokes equations. One is a setting of the finite energy solutions, or Leray weak solutions, in which you assume that the initial data is a square integrable, and then you can construct a solution which is L2 in time, bounded in time with values in L2, and then L2 in time with values in H1. And another setting is when you assume that U0 is in a space which is a scaling invariant, or better. If you look at the scale of LP spaces, you need to assume that U0 is in Ln, where N is a space dimension. So that would be the scaling invariant space. So either, let me write this down. That's a classical settings for solving Navier-Stokes equation. So either the initial velocity is in L2, or U0 is in Ln, or you can put other scaling invariant spaces, like best of spaces, scaling invariant spaces, or more regular, like you can put HS, S greater than n over 2 minus 1 in the scale of Sobolev spaces or R. But the basic settings are this L2 and L. So you can see that in dimension 2 is the same space. In dimension 3 is not the same. Okay. So the dimension 2 is very special from this point of view. The energy space is also scaling invariant. So in the energy, in the finite energy case, that is when you assume that the initial velocity is square integral, then it is already known that the solution goes to zero. In this case, you expect the solution goes to go to zero in L2. And this was proved in the case of Rn by several papers. It has these four papers. It was also proved for Xia domains in a paper by Borchet and Miyakawa. So in the square integral case, we know the solution goes to zero. So now what happens if we don't assume that the velocity is square integral? So let me discuss first the case of the dimension 2, because this is the most complicated and the richest case. That's the case where the square integrable is also the L2 is a critical space, and in fact that's the most important case. So you want to take a velocity which is not square integrable at infinity. Is this physically relevant? It is, because if you take the vorticity, which is another physical quantity, if you take the vorticity to be compactly supported, then you can see that the velocity behaves at infinity like a constant times x orthogonal divided by x x squared. And this is something which is not square integral at infinity. So what happens in this case as far as large time behavior is concerned? To explain what happens, let me introduce first this particular solution of the Navier-Stokes equation, which is called the Lambertine vortex, defined by this formula. The Lambertine vortex is an explicit self-similar solution of the Navier-Stokes equations. Self-similar means that it verifies this identity for all lambda, t, and x. It's a sort of scaling invariant solution. And if you look at the initial velocity for the Lambertine vortex, if you send t to zero, you see that the initial velocity is this vector field, x power divided by 2 pi x squared, and the initial vorticity is the Dirac mass in zero. And it can be observed that not only it's a solution of the Navier-Stokes equation, but also a solution of the heat equation in R2. So why is this, why is the Lambertine vortex important? Because it characterizes the large time behavior of solutions in the case of R2. So now we are here in R2, and it is known that the solution converge to the Lambertine vortex times some constant. Now, the norm in which we measure this convergence, it cannot be the L2 norm because the solutions are not in L2, like we did in the square integral case. So you have to use a different norm, which is this one. It's a weighted in time norm, so I'm taking the LP norm of the solution, multiply by t to the power 1 half minus 1 over p, and take the soup when t is greater than 0. And this is the natural space where the solution lives. If you look, for instance, at this formula here, every self-similar solution, the quantity that I just defined is constant in time. And this is a constant in time for a self-similar solution. So taking the soup is natural. It can be proved mathematically that a solution, if the vorticity belongs to L1, or if it's a measure, then the velocity is in the L2 infinity space. L2 infinity being the Lorentz space, which can be defined by interpolation by also by this formula here, and we know that for a small initial velocity in L2 infinity, we have a global solution in this space, and actually sufficient to have omega zero in L1. So the asymptotic behavior result that I mentioned in the case of R2 is the following, that if you take the vorticity in L1, then we have that U, the solution, converges to M times the Lambertine vortex, where M is the mass of vorticity, the integral of the vorticity. And the convergence, as I said, holds true in this I don't know how to call it. This convergence result was proved first by Giga and Kambe in the case where the L1 norm of the vorticity is small. It was extended by Anna Capio to the case when only the integral of vorticity is small. And then it was proved by Thierry Gallet and Eugene Wayne in the general case. There was no smallness assumption. They also have the next terms in the asymptotic expansion. And I also like to say that again, that this quantity, this weighted in time quantity is constant for a self-similar solution. So from this limit, this asymptotic behavior implies that this quantity goes to a constant times absolute value of M. In particular, the solution doesn't go to zero. It is not expected to go to zero, in contrast to the square integrable case. Okay, so this is in the case of R2. So we can, it is established then that in the full plane and for L1 vorticity, the last time behavior of the solution is given by the Lambertine vortex. Now, for Xtier domains, we don't have this result for many reasons. One of them because if the vorticity in L1, we have no reasonable boundary conditions for the vorticity. In the case of R2, we have a boundedness in L1 of the vorticity. For Xtier domains, we don't know if this remains true or not. And also because the methods that were used in R2 does not go through to the Xtier domain. So there are many reasons why the previous results do not remain true for Xtier domains. At least the proof does not work. What should you do? I'm sorry. So first, As I said, it's not useful to assume that the vorticity is in L1. We cannot really use this information. So if we go back and recall that for compactly supported vorticity, this, the velocity behaves like a multiple of x power divided by x squared at infinity, we could start by assuming that the velocity behaves at infinity like a multiple of this vector field. Meaning that the velocity minus a multiple of its vector field is square integrable. Because in the square integral case, we know that velocity goes to zero. So it's reasonable to assume that this difference here is in L2. So U0 is a L2 perturbation of this vector field. And that's what we did in a previous work. So we assume that the initial velocity is the sum of L2 part plus this vector field. And we proved that if alpha, the coefficient here, is sufficiently small, then we get the same asymptotic behavior as in R2. Meaning that we converge to the Lambertine vortex. And now, I'd like to point out that this smallness condition, this smallness constant, depends on the L2 part. So if the L2 part is large, this alpha zero becomes small. Okay. Now, this result was later improved by Thierry Gallet and Yasunori Maekawa, which they proved almost the same result, except that the L2 part is supposed to be slightly better, like it's going to be an LQ with some Q less than 2. But what they obtain is that the smallness constant is independent of V. So we can take V very large, the alpha will not move. We can be can have the same value of alpha, even for W is large. So we discussed the case when U0 is behaves like x pop divided by x squared at infinity. But we can also consider other behaviors at infinity. For example, we could replace this x power divided by x squared by some other vector field homogeneous of degree minus 1. And another observation, even though in the result that I mentioned until now, the large time behavior is the same as the large time behavior of solution of the heat equation with the same initial data, because the Lambertine vortex is a solution of the heat equation. In fact, there is a general idea that in the Navier-Stokes equation, the linear part is the most important part. It's what dominates the bilinear term. So you first look at the heat equation and then try to prove the same property for the full solution, for the solution of the Navier-Stokes equations. Well, when you take a velocity which is homogeneous of degree minus 1, this is no longer true. We do not expect, in fact, it's not true, that the large time behavior is given by the heat equation. This is because if you start off with an initial velocity which is homogeneous of degree minus 1, you can construct a self-similar solution. I defined a self-similar solution in a previous slide. And for this self-similar solutions, the term with a Laplacian in the Navier-Stokes equation has exactly the same weight as the bilinear term. So for sensitivity solution, the lifetime behavior is not the heat equation. It's just a self-similar asymptotic behavior. It's explicit, if you want. Now we can forget about homogeneity. We can take simply data in L2 infinity. Remember what I told you in R2, if the vorticity is in L1, the velocity is in L2 infinity. So maybe the most general setting would be to take the velocity in L2 infinity, which covers, of course, the case of velocity which is homogeneous of degree minus 1, because functions that are bounded by 1 over mod x are in L2 infinity. It can be easily checked from the definition of the L2 infinity norm. Well, there is a problem without the L2 infinity, is that you don't expect to have a well-defined asymptotic behavior of solutions. At least you don't expect to have this for every initial data in L2 infinity, because there was some example of chaotic behavior in a series of paper by Kaznav, Dickstein, and Weissler, in which they give examples of initial data for which the solution of the Navier-Stokes equation, if you take this, this quantity here, it will have a different limit depending on the sequence of times that you send to infinity. So there is no such limit. It goes to infinity, you have chaotic behavior. So when you take initial data in L to infinity, you don't expect to have an asymptotic behavior of solutions. So what can be done? Well, what we propose is then to compare the solution in the exterior domain to the solution in the full plane or full space, depending on the space dimension. Because if we show that the lifetime behavior of solutions is the same, then we can just use whatever is known in Rn to deduce similar results for exterior domain. So that's what we're going to do. In dimensions 3, we will also consider initial data in L3 infinity. So remember what I said at the beginning, we can take initial data to be either in L2, but then the problem is solved. We could take initial data in L3, but then it's known again that the L3 norm goes to zero for small data. That's, I think it's in the paper of Kato. It was already proved. So then it's left the case of L3 or infinity. So in dimensions 3, we'll also take data in L3 infinity. So in both dimensions, we'll take data in Ln infinity. So basically something that is bounded by 1 over mod x. That's the model of data we are considering. So we want to compare with the solution in the exterior domain to the solutions defined on Rn. So, of course, the question is how to set up the initial data, because you cannot take the same initial data because they are not defined on the same set. One is defined on the exterior domain, one is defined on Rn. So it cannot be the same. So let V0 the data in Rn, U0 the initial data on the exterior domain. So we have to relate U0 to V0 as closely as possible. So what you can do, well, you can think of taking a restriction to omega, take U0 to be V0 restricted to omega, which doesn't work because then u0 will be divergence free, but is not going to vanish at the boundary. In fact, it's sufficient to be a tangent to the boundary for the initial data. Even though the solution vanishes on the boundary for positive times, at initial times, it only needs to be tangent to the boundary, but even tangent to the boundary is not. Or you can use a cutoff, multiplied by a cutoff function. It doesn't work directly because the cutoff will not be a divergence free. It will vanish on the boundary, but will not be divergence free. So what you can do, if you want to do restriction, you have to do restriction, but then you apply the Luray projector in order to make the vector field tangent to the boundary. This is one way to construct U0. Or if you want to do cutoff, you have to cut off the stream function, not the velocity itself. So what is the stream function? Well, I write it like that. It's basically the Laplacian minus one of curl of V. This is the stream function. And you can simply use the cutoff function, which is zero in the neighborhood of the obstacle, and one for large x, and define U0 to be this divergence of F psi. F psi is a stream function. And our results work with both choices. We could put either this or that. It doesn't matter. For technical reasons, the second choice is better because with this choice, U0 actually vanishes on the boundary, while with this choice is only tangent to the boundary. So it's better to be actually vanish on the boundary. Or you can also start with U0 and construct V0. For instance, simply extending U0 with zero values inside the omega. Because with this construction, then V0 will be divergence free. Because U0 is tangent to the boundary, the divergence-free condition is preserved across the boundary. So V0 is a legitimate initial data for the Navier-Stokes equation. So let us define by V the solution of the Navier-Stokes equation in Rn with initial data V0. U, the solution in the X-ray domain, in initial data U0. Then if you take small data in L infinity, then it is known that the solution U exists globally and belongs to this weighted in time space. Maybe I should write down the space because I keep on using it. XP, so it's F such that the sup on T to the power, let me remind me the power is, what was the power? 1 second, the power, 1/2 minus N. F of T in LP so you have there is a solution which belongs a unique solution which belongs to the space XP. It was proved by Kozono Yamazaki for small data. It's interesting to notice that even in dimension 2 the smallest condition is required to have the global existence of U in this space. Because in dimension 2, one might think that everything is known because you have uniqueness, existence and uniqueness of Luray solutions and plenty of results. But even if in Rn, this is not known yet. Okay, so with the U0 and V0 given as on the previous slide, we prove that UFV have the same large time behavior in the case of small initial data. So this is the statement of the theorem in the case of small solutions. Suppose that V0 is in LN infinity with vanishing divergence, sufficiently small, and we construct U0 again either by truncation or by restriction plus application of the Loray projector, then we have that U and V have the same asymptotic behavior, meaning that in the same sense as before, as we had for the Lambertian vortex in the case of R2. Now, some comments on this statement. So first, we can take other initial data, not only the U0, which was constructed as in the previous statement by restriction and or cutoff, but in fact, it's sufficient to assume that U0 and V0 are small in L infinity, and we also need to assume that the difference is in some LQ with Q less than N. This condition, we call this comparable at infinity, meaning that the difference is slightly better than LN infinity. So if the difference is slightly better than LN infinity, and if both initial data are small in LN infinity, then we have the same asymptotic behavior for U and U and V. So why is that? And what is the stability result of Billard, Karsh, and Kanone? It says the following. If you take two solutions on an exterior domain, say both are on an exterior domain, you take two solutions, such that the initial data is small in LN infinity. Then we have this condition, this limit here holds true if and only if it holds true for the Stokes evolution. So if you replace U and V, so U is the Navier-Stokes evolution, V is the Navier-Stokes evolution. If you replace the Navier-Stokes evolution by the Stokes evolution, then you get equivalence. You have that this limit is going to be true if and only if it's true for the Stokes evolutions. So if you take the difference to be in LQ, with Q less than N, it's trivial to see that the Stokes evolution then will verify this limit. This limit to be zero. For the Stokes evolution, we'll have that this limit with zero simply by linearity. Therefore, using the stability result of Billard, Karsh, Kanone, we can extend to have U0 more general, not only the restriction of V0. Okay, and we can. I would like to remark that all these ways of defining U0 by restriction, restriction plus application of Loray projector, and cutoff, all these ways, all these three vector fields are comparable at infinity. So that explains why you can choose either of them as the initial data for the Navier-Stokes equation in the exterior domain. So this is the result for small solutions. Now we can also consider large solutions. Now the statements on large solutions depends on the dimension. As I said, the dimension 2 is very different from the dimension 3. So in dimension 3, the statement is the following. So we take U0, V0 in L3 infinity, comparable at infinity, but not small. We don't assume that they are small. We do assume a smallness assumption, which is that these two quantities are small. And if you have that, then we have the same conclusion, that U and V have the same large time behavior. So to compare to the, with the statement for small solutions, let me recall that the L3 infinity norm can be defined like that. So it's the soup of this quantity that is defined here. And so we only assume that the limit when lambda goes to zero is small, instead of assuming that everything so that is small for all lambda, only when lambda goes to zero. Yes? No, as I said, there is no large time behavior, because you may have chaotic behavior. But what I'm saying is that you will have the same behavior for you. That's all I'm saying. So for V, it may very well that you don't have a well-defined behavior. But what you can do, in the case, for instance, you can start with something which is homogeneous of degree minus one, then in R3 or R2, you have self-similar solution. You have a self-similar solution by the result of Barat, Canon, and Planchon. So that for the exterior domain, you get a large time behavior which is self-similar. So you can an example of large time behavior which is either well-defined or chaotic. You can have both simply by saying that you have the same. In fact, the obstacle doesn't matter. That's the point of my talk. For small data, the obstacle doesn't matter. And also for some for some large solutions, which I'm talking right now. So maybe I can, the proof of this result is not hard. In fact, it can be shown that if you impose this solution, this condition, the solution, although initially large, after some time it becomes small. And this is a trick that was already used in the literature in other settings. So maybe I can give a short proof of this. The idea is to decompose. So suppose that you have this smallness. You suppose that you have this quantity here to be small. Then it is known, that's a lemma. So under this assumption, suppose that this is less than epsilon, then it can be shown that U0 can be written, can be decomposed as a sum of an L2 part, maybe not V0, let me call this something else, say U0 tilde, which is in L2, plus some W0, which is in L3 infinity and small. That's the point, that the L3 infinity norm of W0 is less than epsilon, let's say 2 epsilon, where epsilon, I put epsilon to be this limb soup. Limb soup, lambda goes to zero, of whatever is written there. If it's not, okay, this can, is no. So you decomposed the initial data, then L2 part plus something which is small in L3 infinity. So now you solve the Navier-Stokes equation with this data, say W solution of Navier-Stokes with data W zero, and you put U tilde to be U minus W. You write down an equation for U tilde, and this equation would be dt U tilde minus Laplacian U tilde plus U grad U tilde plus U tilde grad W equal to some pressure. And initially U tilde is in L2, so we're going to make L2 estimate on this equation. You multiply this by U tilde, integrate in space, and you get with standard calculation that you have dt U tilde L2 squared. This you integrate by parts, you get plus grad U tilde L2 squared. Now this multiplied by U tilde integrated will give you zero. And then you have this. The pressure will also be zero. So you only have this term remaining. You put the gradient on the other side. You get that this is going to be equal to U tilde grad U tilde W. And now you do a Holder inequality in Lorentz spaces. You put this in L3 infinity, because that's where you know that W belongs. It's small in L3 infinity. You put this in L2. And this, if you use the Holder inequality in Lorentz spaces, this is going to be in the Lorentz space L6 2. So you are able to bound this by a constant times U tilde L6 2 grad U tilde L2, and then this is going to be less than 2 epsilon. And now, in fact, this is less than this, because you can write U tilde to be minus Laplacian minus 1/2 is basically this gradient U tilde in L6 2, and if you put this operator here is a convolution operator with something which is homogeneous of degree minus 2, so this belongs to this is a convolution with something which belongs to the space. One second. Belongs to the space L 3/2 infinity. Simply by homogeneity, it's homogeneous of degree minus 2. So this is in L3/2 infinity, this is in L2. By the Young inequality for Lorentz spaces, the result is in L6 2. So in the end, you're going to be able to bound this by a constant times epsilon times gradient of U tilde in L2 squared. And if you take epsilon sufficiently small such that this is less then 1/2, then this term, you can put it here. And in the end, you will obtain you get that after integrating in time, too, you obtain that U tilde of T L2 squared plus the integral from 0 to T gradient of U t tilde L2 squared less than U tilde 0, maybe 2 U tilde 0 in L2 squared. So, you obtain that U tilde is L infinity in time with value in L2 because of this, and it's also L2 in time with value in H1 homogeneous, this is in X, because of this. And by interpolation, if you simply write that the H1 half norm is less than the square root of the product of the L2 norm times the H1 norm, this is included in L4 in time with values in H1 half homogeneous. And because H1 half is embedded in L3, you'll have that the H1 half norm is small at some point, is as small as we want. So you get that the L3 infinity norm of U tilde will also be small at some point. And since the W part is always small, because that's a small solution, we get that at some point U tilde is small, and then it stays small by the small data theory. So the solution becomes small after a certain time, and then you can apply the small data theorem. So that's how you prove the large solutions theorem in dimension 3. Now, in dimension 2, the theorem is less pretty. It's much more complicated. So I wrote a statement. So again, it looks the beginning. It looks pretty much like what we already saw. I am assuming that the initial velocity has an L2 part U0 tilde plus an L2 infinity part U0 bar, which is small in L2 infinity. So large here, meaning that this U0 tilde can be as large as possible. But the L2 infinity part still needs to be small. And we also need to assume a second smallness assumption on U0 bar. So there are a lot of smallness assumptions on U0 bar. There is nothing on the L2 part, but a lot of the assumptions on U0 bar. We have to assume this smallest condition, where T epsilon is the time where the Navier-Stokes solution starting from U0 tilde has a small L2 norm. Because we know that the finite energy result, we know that the Navier-Stokes solution from U0 tilde becomes small, is small in L2 norm after some time, denote by T epsilon this time, and we have to impose this additional smallest condition on U0 bar. Here, exponential minus TA is a Stokes operator, meaning that it's the same PD, it solves the same PD as an Navier-Stokes, except that we dump the bilinear term, without the bilinear term. Then we need to assume exactly the same for V0, and also that the L2 infinity parts for U0 and V0 are comparable at infinity, then we have the same asymptotic behavior. And if you take the particular case of our previous result that I mentioned, it's included here. And you can, moreover, you can simplify a little bit this additional smallness assumption you add that U0 bar is in some LQ with Q greater than 2, then you can replace this smallest assumption by this, which is maybe a little bit more explicit. It's still not very explicit because you still have the T epsilon here. Well, T epsilon can be made explicit if you further assume that U0 tilde is better than L2, say, is in LP with P less than 2, because then in this case, you have you actually have a decay rate for the solution of the Navier-Stokes equation, as was proved by Maria Schombeck. So you, if you made a little more assumptions on U0 tilde, you can actually say what this T epsilon is in terms of U0 tilde. Okay, and maybe a last slide. You can reformulate the hypothesis in the more aesthetic form, which is written here. So we assume that U0 tilde is in L2, that U0 bar is in L2 plus belongs to this best of space, B minus 1/2 4 4. This best of space means exactly that these norms here are finite. That's exactly what it says. Then you have to assume that the L2 infinity norm of U0 bar is small, and also that the best of norm is small compared to U0 tilde. Okay, then we have the same asymptotic behavior when t goes to infinity. So, as a conclusion, what we find out is that the asymptotic behavior is the same for small solutions, also for some large solutions. I guess should be true. I suspect that is true even for all solutions. So I don't think the obstacle can be seen. Well, maybe it will be seen if we look for the next terms in the asymptotic expansion, as was done by Thierry Gallet and Eugene Wayne in the case of R2, when they made they computed the next term in the asymptotic behavior, which are not able to do on X-tier domains for technical reasons, mainly because when you look at the Stokes evolution, we don't have enough estimates for the Stokes evolution. It's a linear equation. It's like the heat equation in R2, but we don't have enough estimates. Namely, we don't have gradient estimates for the solution of the Stokes equation. Because of that, we're not able to find the next term in the asymptotic behavior. And maybe the obstacle will show up in the next term. So I will stop here. Thank you for your attention.
Any questions?